Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Elk and Beaver Lake Public Forum. I'm Adele Lay, a member of the Environmental Law Center, which is co-hosting this event with the Golden Rods and Reels Society. I'd first like to recognize that we are on unceded Straits and Coast Salish territory. This is a territory of the Lekwungen-speaking people from Esquimalt and the Songhees First Nation. Thank you for coming. I imagine that many of you are part of the 1 million visitors to the park each year who love these lakes and want a solution. So to better understand the health problems facing Elk and Beaver Lake and the many possible solutions, we are lucky to have three expert speakers here tonight. Firstly, Dr. Rick Nordin of the BC Lake Stewardship Society will present his research about the current state of the lakes. Dr. Nordin holds a PhD in aquatic biology from UBC, which he got in 1974, and he then worked for the BC Ministry of the Environment until 2002. There, he was a provincial limnologist, which is a specialist in the area of water quality. He was also an adjunct professor at the UVic Department of Biology until 2012, where he taught and did research on lakes. After we hear from Dr. Nordin, we'll take a few questions for him and then move on with our two final speakers. Next, we'll hear from Erin Gray, who will discuss laws, policies, and community initiatives that have cleaned up similar lakes elsewhere. Erin graduated from the University of Victoria's Law School last spring and is completing her articles at the UVic Environmental Law Center. While attending law school, Erin was the president of the Environmental Law Club, as well as the Student Animal Legal Defense Fund. She is a recipient of the Law Foundation of British Columbia's 2015 Public Interest Award. Her many fondest childhood memories involved lakes in BC's interior, including Shuswap and the Okanagan, which have suffered similar issues as Elk and Beaver. Since she moved to the island, she's developed an attachment to the many local outdoor attractions, including our beautiful Elk and Beaver Lakes. Along with ELC's legal director, Calvin Sanborn, she co-authored the opinion editorial on the algae issue in last Sunday's Times Colonist. After Erin, we will hear from Michelle Hawryluk, who's been an environmental impact assessment biologist for the Ministry of Environment since 2013. She's been involved with the efforts to improve water quality on Elk and Beaver through coordination of the steering committee, design and assistance with sampling programs on the lakes, liaising with the organizations like Golden Rods and Reels and the Victoria Fish and Game Protective Association, and representing the ministry at forums like these. After Michelle and Erin speak, we'll have time for questions. But before we get to our speakers, we will have one more introductory remark by Robert McConnell of the Golden Rods and Reels Society. Robert?
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for being here. This is a shameless plea for support. The fact that you're here and the fact that this presentation, this forum can take place is due to the initiative that the Golden Rods and Reels began 2.5 years ago, and that my colleague Mick Collins, whom you'll hear from later, has done so much to bring to fruition. Along the way, we've been joined by a lot of other people, three of whom are on the stand here, who have provided invaluable support and guidance. The Golden Rods and Reels, you must understand, is a small organization. We have about 45 members, and the average age of our members is well north of 80. So in order to keep moving ahead, and we do need to keep moving ahead and broadening the effort to bring good things to Elk Lake, we need a broader base of support, and we need your support. We probably need some kind of stewardship group that has a broad community base. If at the end of the evening, any of you are interested in finding out more about that possibility or supporting it, we urge you to leave your name and number on one of the sign-up sheets so that we can contact you as we try to move into the next generation of stewardship for Elk Lake. Thank you very much.
Dr. Nordin, welcome your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Adele. And I'm very pleased at the turnout. We had no idea how many people would be interested in Elk Lake, but I'm very gratified. And what I'm going to try to do is just give you a bit of a background that's not too technical on what's going on with Elk Lake and what's happened with Elk Lake over the last 150 years. Elk Lake really is one of the sort of jewels of Victoria, and it really has deteriorated, certainly in the last couple of decades, to the point where it needs some attention. The first slide I have on the left-hand side is a little ad from the 1920s. Elk Lake at that time was a destination resort. People would come out to Elk Lake and stay and enjoy it, and you get an idea of it was a very different place than it is now. The photo on the right is one of the warning panels that's been put up around the lake, because over the last 5 or 6 years there's been quite a number of episodes of cyanobacterial blooms, blue-green algal blooms, which are worrying as an environmental indicator and also as a public health concern. This is a double picture. This was a wonderful picture out of a book. It's a book on bringing water to Victoria. Charles Tolman, thank you. So this picture was taken probably just after Elk Lake had been flooded, had been filled to its present level. And you can see Bear Hill in both the pictures. So there's quite a similarity, you know, in that intervening period. But there have been a lot of things have changed. Just to start off with, I'd like to very quickly go through, I think, what are some of the significant events of Elk Lake. Lakes in general, in most cases, are in geological terms, temporary kinds of features. Elk Lake was formed about 10,000 years ago. That's really dark. And over that 10,000 years, it's probably accumulated about 10 or 12 meters of sediment in the bottom. And so Elk Lake, over time, over another 10 or 20,000 years, will disappear. But we'd certainly like to keep it in the condition that it's in for our immediate future anyway. One of the bigger events that happened with the watershed is European settlement, obviously. Land clearing and agriculture after 1850. If you can imagine what the Elk Lake watershed was like in the 1850s, it would be something more like Mount Doug Park or Bear Hill Park, heavily treed Douglas firs, and that was all cut down. A major event was the impoundment, a dam being put in at the outlet of Beaver Creek or Colquitt's Creek in 1874. And this is the picture of the beaver lam. This is from Charles Tolman's book again. The dam raised the level of Elk Lake by 5 meters, which is quite astonishing. Beaver Lake at that time was just a little pond, and it was described in that time as being a swamp. So the Elk Lake looked quite different then. The picture on the right is a bathymetric map, a reverse topographic map of Elk Lake. And the one on the right is what I'm judging what Elk and Beaver Lake looked like in 1874 before the dam was put in. It would have been two quite separate lakes connected by a small stream, and Beaver would not have been very much of a significant lake at all. So it was a very different place than it is now. It was used after the dam was put in and the filter beds were put in, part of which you can still see at Beaver Lake Park. It was used as a drinking water supply up until 1914. Not very enthusiastically, because it wasn't very good quality then even. And after you flood a lake like that, all kinds of organic materials and all kinds of other problems. So it was used mostly for agricultural purposes up until the 1970s. In the 40s, after the Second World War, there was a lot of residential development. 1960, the Pat Bay Highway was put through. One of the significant things about the Pat Bay Highway, in a report that was done in 1992, there are 16 storm drains along the highway that drain into the lake, which I'm sure has some consequence to the lake. The lake is very popular. It has 1.5 million visits a year and is by far and away the most popular fishing lake on the island. So the lake, because of all of these things, has never really come into equilibrium with itself. It's never become a stable kind of system because of a whole lot of things that I've just mentioned. The dam, the lake volume increased dramatically, the lake surface increased significantly. And there's been a lot of species introductions into the lake, fish and bullfrogs and plants, and a lot of the things that we don't know because there's never really been a good survey done. And the last thing, and I'll mention a little bit more later, is climate change. So there's, you know, a number of factors that are bearing on what's going on in Elk Lake. The problems that are seen by the public and the users are the aquatic plants in the lake, which are very dense, very diverse. It's a lake that aquatic plants like a lot because it's full of nutrients. It's got very nice rich sediments. The water quality deterioration over time is quite noticeable in the data, and I'll talk a bit about the data later. The other biggest perception by the public, and particularly by fishermen, is the loss of fish habitat and fisheries productivity. And then introduced species, again, being a problem. There's a whole list of previous studies that have been done. One of the major ones was 1992 by the Ministry of Environment, but there have been a whole lot of others by fisheries, by Saanich and by CRD. There was, at one time, in 1991, a plan for a watershed plan, and it just sort of somehow faded away. There's been a number of UVic graduate students, mostly been using UVic as a point of reference, I guess. They were mostly working on Souk Reservoir and Shawnigan Lake, but Elk Lake was such a nice contrast to these other lakes that there was a variety of miscellaneous data that had been gathered by them. 2.5 years ago, the Golden Rods and Reels provided the sort of spark plug to get something going, and there was a stewardship program set up with help from the rowing club and a lot of other people, and data gathered and a couple of reports written. We have a grad student from UVic right now, Lisa Rogers, who's doing a master's degree, which will help a lot with understanding how the lake functions. There was a report commissioned by the Ministry of Environment in Nanaimo to look at restoration options, which is in draft at this point. I think Michelle will talk about that in a bit. And there will be water quality objectives report done. So there are a lot of things going on and have gone on. There were water quality objectives done in the McKean report in 1992, but these are quantitative sort of goals of what water quality should be. Unfortunately, most of the goals were never met. They were just, it's just not, not very good water quality. So the water quality problem is a function of the aquatic plants, the algal blooms, and the deep water oxygenation, which I will try to explain very quickly. Most lakes stratify, thermally stratify. In the summertime, the water absorbs heat, energy from the sun, and the water becomes less dense. And lakes will stratify into two separate layers, a warm upper layer and a deep colder layer. And these layers are quite difficult to mix because the densities are quite different. It really is like oil floating on water. So that in the wintertime, the lake will mix completely top to bottom. In the summertime, it's stratified into these two layers, a top warm layer and a deep cold layer. The problem with the stratification is that the oxygen in this deep cold layer is used up by decaying biological material. Algae and plants dying use up the oxygen, and for most of the summer in Elk Lake, that bottom half of the lake has no oxygen in it, which has consequences for fish. It means that no fish can actually get into that layer to feed. It means that there's no cold water refuge for salmonids. It means that benthic productivity, the invertebrates in the bottom, is much lower than it would be if there was oxygen in the bottom of the lake. And this is one of the reasons for, one of the proposals is for an aerator to put air back into that oxygen, into that deep water. So the lake goes through this cycle of mixing in the wintertime and stratifying in the summertime. But the stratification is very intense, and the oxygen depletion is very intense. So there are a number of limitations of the lake itself. It has a very small watershed by most standards. So one of the consequences of that is there's very little water that falls in the watershed that actually moves through the lake. So the flushing rate, so-called, is very long. If you drained Elk Lake tomorrow, it would take probably around 8 years to refill. So there's very little water going through the lake. The stratification also has one other unfortunate consequence in that when the oxygen is lost in the bottom waters, all of that accumulated very rich bottom sediments undergo a chemical change, and that phosphorus that's stored in those rich sediments comes back out of the sediments and into the water, into the lake again. And most of the phosphorus supply to the lake actually comes from those rich bottom sediments at this point. The best estimate is somewhere between 85% and 90%. So if the phosphorus is going to be controlled, and phosphorus is the key to the productivity of the lake, the amount of algae that grows, the amount of fish that are there, and if you want to reduce the amount of algae and weeds in the lake, the phosphorus supply has to be reduced. And the largest supply right now is that internal loading from the deep sediments. Just a couple of photos of sort of the consequences. The photo on the right is one of the stewardship samplers, and this is a bloom from last January at the rowing club. And it's quite spectacular, and it's quite toxic stuff. And any of you who walk dogs around is certainly something to avoid. And if you're a swimmer, it's also something to avoid as well. The picture on the left was some samples taken the year before that when it became obvious that this bloom was toxic, the decision was made to move the New Year's polar bear swim to Thetis Lake rather than have swimmers swim in an algal bloom. The health consequences of these blooms are pretty serious. I tried not to put a whole lot of technical stuff in here. The top graph here is phosphorus, again, the key element to controlling the water quality in Elk Lake. And this is a graph from 1980 to present. And in general, if you look at the phosphorus concentration at spring overturn, which is a key time, there is a significant upward trend, certainly even over that short period of time. The bottom graph shows deep water phosphorus, and what I talked about before, the amount of phosphorus in that deep water that comes out of the sediments that increases over the course of the summer. And it's quite spectacular. So we have to look at Elk Lake in terms of overall ecology and the ecological change that's taken place, because I don't think there is a magic bullet that will cure Elk Lake. There are just so many things that have changed and so many things that are different. One of the remarkable things is that Elk Lake, initially, at least up until the 1950s, had only three species of fish in it. Four, rainbow trout was introduced quite a long time ago. But the historical fish community in Elk Lake was cutthroat, bullhead, and prickly sculpin. That's all. Now we have rainbow trout, which is an intentional introduction, as well as carp and sunfish, perch, and large and smallmouth bass, all of which were intentionally introduced by other fishermen, presumably, to provide that fishing experience. There's also evidence in terms of ecology that there's been a major change in the zooplankton, which are the small animals in the plankton of the lake. They've been reduced quite dramatically, probably because of pressure, grazing pressure from the perch and from the sunfish. So their numbers are very low now compared to historical, the fragmentary historical numbers. The benthic community, the small invertebrates that live in that rich bottom sediments, seem to also have been reduced very dramatically. And the consequence, it's a very large community and very significant. Most of you have been at Elk Lake, and if you're there and you see the swallows out, you know, skimming off the top of the water, they're not drinking water. What they're doing is picking insects off the surface. These insects from the bottom emerge, come to the surface, and fly away unless the swallows get them. So that community, that benthic community, that invertebrate community has been reduced very substantially according to the historical data. Aquatic plants, they're very dense. They've been managed over the last 50 years, but they are still seen as a major impediment to recreational use, swimming, rowing, and fishing. Climate change is probably another factor which we probably won't have much control over, but certainly with increased water temperature and longer stratification period, we're going to get faster growth of plants, we're going to get more internal loading of phosphorus. So all of these factors have to come into account. Just some pictures. Upper left is carp. There's a very large population of carp. Carp have a very bad reputation for stirring up the bottom and resuspending the sediments, putting those sediments back in the water. So increasing the nutrients by stirring up the bottom. And I'm sure there are fishermen here who can tell you there's some very large carp in Elk Lake. Upper right is a bullfrog tadpole. There are a lot of bullfrog tadpoles in Elk Lake, as well as adult bullfrogs. Yellow perch is Eastern North American. It's been introduced. A difficult fish to control. And otherwise, the two bottoms are the weed problem and the algae. So this is just a list of, of what I see as the science needs. There's a whole lot of different restoration techniques. I don't think any of them fit exactly, but there needs to be probably a better understanding of what's going on in the lake, and I think we're gaining that at this point, but we're certainly not there. There's also, some organizational needs. One of them is that there's a lot of jurisdictional overlaps or undefined jurisdictional responsibilities in the lake, and those have to be straightened out. I think there is need for cooperation between government and academia and NGOs like Golden Rods and Reels. Certainly, I'm pleased that that you, Vic, has been a part of this, and I hope that you, Vic, will continue to be a contributor and a partner. I think we have three problems. We have the plants as being a problem, we have water quality as being a problem, and we have fisheries as being a problem. And all of those probably require different approaches and different solutions to dealing with them. But I would certainly emphasize the absolute importance of Elk Lake. It really needs to be dealt with as an ecosystem, the watershed and the lake together. Dealing with individual problems usually doesn't really work, so it really needs to be looked at in the bigger scope. Just to thank you, the introduction said this was my research. It's not. This was put together by a whole lot of different groups. I was just the compiler. So this is just a list of all of the people that I could think of that have contributed to this and will probably continue to. And so I just like to say thank you to all of them for the progress that we've made so far. Anyway, I think is there questions? Am I?
We're going to do questions.
Okay.
But thank you, Rick, for your presentation.
Okay.
So Mick Collins of Rods and Reels has asked us to just have two or three questions to Rick on the problems, not on the solutions, because Erin is going to talk about solutions that have been used elsewhere. We're going to hear from the Ministry of Environment about the solutions they have, and you're going to tell us about your solutions momentarily. But first of all, do we have a couple questions for Rick just on the nature of the problems that we face there?
There is, but it's fairly small. There is the O'Donnell Creek is the biggest stream coming in, and there's agriculture. There have been estimates of septic inputs. So agriculture, stormwater contribute a small amount. That's what really got the whole thing started as it built up. But now that major contribution is actually the accumulation that's in the bottom of the lake. So there is a watershed management aspect that has to be dealt with as well, yes. Yes. Yeah, there's a direct correlation between higher concentrations of phosphorus and these blooms. These blooms require quite large amounts of phosphorus. So there's a direct correlation.
I'll use the mic just in case no one can hear me. I just wanted to know, is the goal to get rid of the algae, or are you altogether, or are you trying to protect it?
No, I mean, the algae are an integral part of the ecosystem. I mean, they're the base of the food chain. I mean, we just want to reduce the amount of algae that's there, the same way we want to reduce the amount of aquatic plants that are there. Aquatic plants are essential. They're good fish habitat, but they've you know, like the algae, they've grown to an excessive amount at this point.
So if you could decrease the algae and you could increase the dissolved oxygen, that would be ideal.
Yes. Yeah. That's certainly two of the goals.
How deep is the sediment at the bottom of the lake, part one? And you mentioned 60 road runoffs from Pat Bay that might be interfering. Can you quantify anything about the mite? What do you think is in there? How deep is the sediment and Pat Bay runoff?
The sediment, we did a core a number of years ago, and I think it was about 12 or 13 meters deep in the center.
So that's introduced sediment, or sediment accumulated since the lake?
That's accumulated in the last 10,000 years. It accumulates at a few millimeters a year, but you know, over that time, that much has accumulated. The second question was on...
The runoff from the Pat Bay Highway.
Yeah. There, as far as I know, there's been no monitoring done since that study in 1988. But yeah, there's drainage, storm drains off the highway that I'm not sure what the consequence is.
Thank you.
But certainly that raises the possibility of using rain gardens to filter that stormwater.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a rain garden just outside the building here that filters the water off of UVic.
Can I assume that you're also including Beaver Lake and the beaver ponds that, as they're evolving in this? You're just using the words Elk Lake, but Beaver Lake is very much a part of that area?
Yes, that's my own abbreviation, I guess. Yeah, I mean Elk and Beaver. I mean the Beaver Lake or the Beaver Bay part of Elk Lake is certainly well used and an important part of the lake, yes.
And just a second question. I live right on the edge of Beaver Lake, right at the edge of the park. We used to see the I don't know what they're called, but the machines that would go in the lake and dig up the milfoil and that sort of thing. And we haven't seen them for quite a number of years now. Do you know why?
It wore out. It was in place for, I guess it was in use for almost 40 years, and basically it just wore out. There is an initiative now by CRD to replace that machine.
Any other questions? Oh, here's right over here.
It's an anglers group that has brought this attention to the problems at the lake, and I'm wondering your opinions about how VHA is dealing with the public health issues, and we've talked about the correlation between the cyanobacteria and neurotoxic diseases like ALS and MS when it becomes in an aerosol form. And how is VHA dealing with the public health crisis?
I'm not sure they're looking at it at this point.
Right.
And It's one of those jurisdictional things that they do monitor the beaches for coliforms, but that aspect of it, I'm not sure they've done any sampling about that.
And it's not the coliform that's killing the dogs and sending people to hospital like rowers with neurotoxic symptoms. So I just wondered what role VHA is playing in this, because this is you're a group of volunteer anglers that have put this project together.
Yeah. There are a lot of agencies that need to be drawn into this, and I certainly think VHA is one of them, yes.
Is VHA here tonight? Okay, you might want to contact VHA and invite them to the next event.
One of the places you haven't mentioned is the shoreline.
Yes.
So many changes, and the last major change was when they raised the lake the last time, and it destroyed the wetlands all along the north end of the lake. And I have to think that those were contributing to the health of the lake California died because they raised it. It wasn't that much of a level increase, but it was enough to kill all the bulrushes, all the wood lilies. So I wonder if you had in your work looked at shoreline.
Yeah.
And its contribution to the health of the lake.
Yeah. That's an embarrassing question, actually. I mean, as biologists, we tend to look out in the middle of the lake and assume that, you know, represents what the lake is like. So a lot of our data is for the open water, and we don't have a very good idea of what the shoreline, the littoral, is like.
Yeah, because I can tell you what it used to look like, and I can tell you what used to happen in front of my house. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Those things, they used to be frogs, and Mick also preyed on the frogs. I never worried about the bullfrogs because the mink definitely took care of that problem in the big time. The mink population has not been plumbed, it's vanished. It's gone. There are no mink, there are no crayfish.
Yeah.
The lake is gone.
The lake has gone through a lot of changes in the last 30 years. I agree.
Erin Gray is going to be talking about how in other lakes the wetland restoration has been a key part of cleaning up the lake. So,
plant species that the park has got a real problem with.
Good question. I don't know. What, I mean, you're talking about dryland plants rather than riparian plants?
Yeah, they've got invasive English ivy all over the place now, overtaking have been some phenomenal area that was for past. There used to be sheets at several different places of wildflowers in the spring that are nearly gone now.
I mean, as a general principle, I mean, whatever changes in the watershed happen are going to affect the lake, I mean, as a principle. But as a direct linkage, I'm not sure.
Okay, maybe one more question. I see somebody up here. And then we will have questions at the end for other people that have questions.
We've done some water quality sampling downstream in Colquitts and are seeing really high levels of pHs. Is that at all, might that be associated with the phosphorus in any way?
The high pH is usually a consequence of algal blooms. When the algae grow to excess, they change the pH. They take the CO2 out of the water and the pH goes up. So there may be a correlation with either a lot, you know, very active plant growth or an algal bloom.
Okay, so let's move on to the solutions part of the program here. Thank you very much, Rick, and we will have. Okay, so when the Rods and Reels Society came to the Environmental Law Center, they described these problems to us and asked what we could do. Well, we're lawyers. We don't know much about science, but what we can do as lawyers is we can ask law students like Roshan Leiter, who worked on this project initially, and Erin Gray, who has worked on it latterly, to look at what laws have been established elsewhere, what policies have been established elsewhere, what's worked elsewhere. And so Erin is going to talk about that. And after that, we'll hear from the Ministry of Environment and then from you. And hopefully, we can fashion some solutions.
So thank you so much for coming. It's really heartening to see how many people care about the future of these beautiful lakes. So I'm going to speak about the possible techniques that have been used in other lakes with similar problems as Elk and Beaver Lakes. I've broken them into two categories. This is how they're typically broken down. There's in-lake solutions, which deal with the internal phosphorus loading that Dr. Nordin just outlined for you. These are lakes within the body of the lake. Then there's the external sources. So these are typically referred to as input management techniques, which deal with what's going into the lake and what's contributing to increasing phosphorus. So we're going to go through 9 case studies that we looked at. Like I said, they're all mostly urbanized watersheds that have had some similar problems with algae blooms, invasive species, and invasive weeds, as Elk and Beaver Lake have seen. So first I'll just go through a couple of the in-lake and input management techniques that are often used. The first one is subsurface aeration. Dr. Nordin mentioned why dissolved oxygen in the bottom sediments is important. So this is one of the techniques used to infuse oxygen into those deep layers. So you can see there's a diagram on the left, and then a picture of one of these at Langford Lake on the right, and that you can get a sense of the scale. There's a person in that picture, so he's about as tall as the person. Next is dredging. So this is actually removing the sediments. Usually they transport them out, they dewater, send the water back in, the clean water, and then they dispose of that nutrient-rich sediment that they've removed. It also deepens the lake, which helps reduce phosphorus, and they can dredge the tributaries so that there's better flushing into the lake, which helps with lowering nutrients as well. So this is at Delavan Lake in Wisconsin, which I will discuss later. The third is alum. This is aluminum sulfate, and it helps to inactivate the phosphorus that's in the lake. So this is a machine that's applying alum at Green Lake in Seattle. And the fourth in-lake solution that we're looking at is, or that we looked at in our research, is harvesting fish. There are problematic species that burrow into the deep sediments. They release phosphorus. They also sometimes eat the zooplankton that would eat the algae. And so when they're gone, that removes another important part of the puzzle. And they also carry nutrients in their bodies, so when they decompose, they contribute back to the nutrients. So this is a really extensive gizzard shad harvesting that happened at Lake George in Florida. So as for the input management techniques, so lots of things can contribute to phosphorus in lakes. Things like septic, agricultural runoff, stormwater drains, fertilizer. So a really important one is the septic and getting septics onto sewers has been a technique used at many of the lakes that we looked at. And then changing behaviors. So whether it be by public education or by regulation, dealing with fertilizer runoff. So educating people on the availability of non-phosphorus fertilizers, for example, or better septic maintenance is another really good one. So that can be done through education or by regulation. And the last one is constructed wetlands. So you can construct wetlands sort of on the perimeter. These absorb and hold the nutrient-rich water before it enters into the lakes. And actually, one additional technique that I didn't put up here but is important is in Ontario, they've used something called lake capacity models or phosphorus loads. So it's almost giving a phosphorus budget to the lake and then not allowing, say, any more septic homes on septic if it's already at its sort of budget. So that's one way to manage this sort of thing. So now on to the case studies. The first one that's important to mention is Lake Washington in Seattle. It's famous because it was a lake that solved its algae problem
by diverting sewage. So the city of Seattle dumped raw sewage into this lake for decades. And by 1968, they fully diverted it all to a waste treatment plant near Puget Sound. In what was at the time the most expensive pollution control effort in the United States. It was $140 million. M. Thomas Edmondson, he was at the University of Washington. He's the scientist that researched this lake and the phosphorus levels found that they were linked to the algae that they were seeing. So by 1976, the algae had become insignificant. Water quality steadily improved into the 90s. There have been recent blooms in recent years, and there was a closure of the lake last spring. This has been attributed to climate change, so it's something they're going to have to look at again. But Lake Washington's important just because it sort of it changed the old consensus, which was that lake eutrophication or elevated phosphorus levels was irreversible. So closer to home, Langford Lake. So it is eutrophic as well. It installed a efficient aerator in 1985, which worked well, but became less effective over time. They replaced it in 2012. Alongside the aerator, a centralized sewer system was implemented. Connecting old homes was voluntary, but all new homes were required to connect. The Langford Lakes and Areas Protection Society, which I'm told is now called the West Shore Watershed Society, is a group of citizen advocates that monitor the lake. They cooperate with government and other societies to improve the lake and the surrounding areas. They've engaged in public education activities. So the actual outcome of the aerators was initially positive. But by 2005, the temperatures were the same as the pre-aerator conditions. So this new aerator was installed that I mentioned in 2012. There was a 2012 bloom, but it was attributed to timing. So the aerator was turned off too early in the year. A report to Langford City Council in 2014 said that Langford and Glen Lake, which I'll describe next, had excellent conditions for fish habitat. So there has been an improvement. But then this year there was a no swim advisory. So it seems to sort of be this constant battle. But the aerators were certainly effective for a time. So Glen Lake in Langford, its issues are septic and agricultural runoff. An aerator was installed in 1985 and then replaced in 2005 due to decreased performance and corrosion. And in 2007, a city bylaw required all lakefront properties to connect to sewer. I believe 12 properties are still on septic on this lake, but the majority are on sewer. So the move to sewer and the aerator are apparently improving water quality, except for a bloom in 2008, which also was attributed to some timing that was off, turning it off too soon. There have been no extreme phosphorus levels since the aerator was installed. So I think Langford and Glen Lakes are a reminder that aerators seem to require inspection and monitoring on a frequent basis to ensure they're effective. So St. Mary Lake on Salt Spring Island also has issues with algal blooms due to urban runoff. They installed an aerator as well. In 1985, this seemed to improve the water quality and fish habitat initially. Was replaced in 2008 2008. Then it was turned off in 2013 because the algal blooms hadn't gotten better. The Salt Spring Island Watershed Protection Authority just released a report last week that found that the aerators didn't work because of two reasons. First, they probably stirred up the bottom sediments, and we know that releases phosphorus back into the water. And two, the magnitude of the actual internal loading or internal phosphorus was less than they had thought. So the report recommends further study and looking at some of these input management techniques to address external sources. Things like septic, agriculture runoff, and stormwater runoff. So the next is Lake George. It's located in a highly urbanized watershed in Florida. The main issues are wastewater, farm, and stormwater runoff, as well as problematic gizzard shad fish species. So from 1993 to 2012, approximately 100 water quality projects have been conducted involving stormwater, septic, public education. And I don't have a total cost for all of them, but the 32 most recent were expected to cost about $17 million. The reason we looked at this case is because of the fish. So they engaged in some pretty extensive gizzard shad harvesting. From 2013 to 2014, 20,000 pounds of phosphorus were removed from the lake by removing 2.5 million pounds of fish. And then the algal blooms continued. So another shad harvest happened just this past summer. And the results of this aren't known quite yet, but I've got the cost up here for those. It was 3 years. It wasn't 2012. It was 2013. It was $2.5 million. So one kind of interesting public education initiative that was undertaken on this lake was in 2011, one of the citizen groups had 2,000 people come aboard a floating classroom, which was a retrofitted pontoon boat, and people learned about lake protection and ecology. So it was really interesting to get people on board with some of the restoration techniques to fix that lake. So next is the Okanagan Basin, which includes six lakes, one of which is Okanagan Lake. So they ran into water quality issues in the 60s, which spurred the founding of the Okanagan Basin Water Board. Their board of directors includes the Okanagan Nation Alliance, which has represents eight member First Nation communities, as well as reps from the three regional districts in the area. So they commissioned a study that found that sewage was the main issue with what they were experiencing at that lake. I found this very interesting. The study quantified the social and environmental benefits of the lake in dollars. And this was done in the 70s. And this was to sort of justify the cost, the like pretty high cost of the restoration techniques that they wanted to bring in. So the board, they pushed wastewater initiatives. They lobbied the province for regulation. They established grants for communities who wanted to pay for sewage upgrades. They identified problem septic areas within the watershed and tried to get them on sewer. And so since 1990, there have been significant improvements in sewerage, and laws have been put in place at both the provincial and local level. And these efforts have led to a 90% reduction in phosphorus over 20 years. And additionally, a tax was levied on properties within the watershed, which generated $40 million over 20 years, and that was used to fund these restoration efforts. So the Okanagan has been the recipient of some good educational initiatives. This one's by Natural Resources Canada, and it's to property owners to show them what kind of modifications in some of their household activities can help reduce the toxins going down the storm drain and then into the waterways. So things like washing your car, not at home, but at a car wash, say, sweeping your leaves onto your lawn or your dirt, not onto the road, collecting rainwater, disposing of hazardous substances properly, picking up pet waste, because animal waste is a source of phosphorus, and having thick soil and thick gravel on your property to help filter and retain rainwater. So next is the chain of lakes in Minneapolis. So this is five lakes. They sit in a huge 1,500-acre urban park. Their algae issues are not surprisingly caused by urban runoff. The state government established the Clean Water Partnership in 1987, which conducted many restoration efforts, including alum treatment in four of the lakes, constructed wetlands, sedimentation basins, and wet detention ponds to intercept stormwater and capture nutrients. And one of the lakes was dredged, and that was the only technique that was found in that case not to be effective. The stormwater ponds achieved a 25 to 66% phosphorus removal rate, so that was considered to be quite a success. And alongside all the in-lake and input management efforts, there was much public education. So starting in 1993 and continuing to the present day, there have been materials distributed throughout the watershed that bring attention to best management practices, watershed awareness of the drainage into the lakes. For one of the examples was the importance of non-phosphorus fertilizers. The materials were as diverse as bookmarks, table tents and paper placemats for restaurants, billboards, and utility bill inserts. So these efforts paid off quite quickly, as there was a 50% reduction in pesticides and stormwater. So overall, the US EPA, or Environmental Protection Agency, has documented measurable water quality improvements throughout the chain of lakes. And in total, the Clean Watership or Water Partnership efforts cost $12.4 million. And this is a map of the chain of lakes with the restoration initiatives overlaid. So you can see they're pretty varied and they're pretty dispersed throughout the chain of lakes. So next is Delavan Lake in Wisconsin. They've had blooms from residential and agricultural runoff. During the 80s, sewers were installed to reduce the septic runoff. That cost $50 million. And a rehabilitation plan was started in 1989 that included dredging the lake bottom, building ponds to capture sediment from a feeding creek, building a peninsula to divert sediment-laden waters, and building a dam to further help control inflow. They also eradicated a problematic fish population and restocked the whole lake. They added alum to inactivate the phosphorus. Those efforts cost $7 million. And the plan was considered a success because the water clarity improved significantly. So in 2006 and 2008, they had to conduct some maintenance dredging for an additional cost of $1.5 million. And at that time, they determined that alum wouldn't have been appropriate because there was an ecologically sensitive area, and they were worried about how it might affect the fish and other species in that area. In 2005, so similar to what happened in the Okanagan, where they did this study to value the lake in economic terms, they did that here as well, and it allowed the chairman of the town board to say, although the cost of dredging is high, the cost of not dredging is higher. And so he relied on this study to say that. And so just for interest's sake, the lake was valued at $77 million in local spending and 812 jobs and $17 million in direct labor income. So the maintenance dredging that they conducted was considered a success. Due to the increased water depth and the improved flushing. And as of 2011, they expected to have to do dredging again in 10 to 15 years. And I should mention the lake committee. So there was a multiple stakeholder committee established, the city of Delavan, the county, various departments of the US federal government, a regional planning commission, the engineering department of the University of Wisconsin, and an NGO all formed this lake committee that worked through these initiatives. Oh, sorry, that's my next one. Right, so lastly, Green Lake in Seattle is an urban lake that receives 1 million visitors a year, so similar number, actually we receive more, but similar attraction. It's had an issue with blooms since 1916. Since it has, so its majority of its phosphorus is internal phosphorus, like apparently what is at Elk and Beaver Lakes. So they used alum first in 1991, along with a few other initiatives, some public education, weed harvesting. They diluted the water, the lake with excess drinking water. They controlled the goose population because it was contributing with its waste. And the alum was expected to last 5 to 8 years, but it ended up only lasting 3 to 5 years. So they redid the alum treatment, but significantly more in 2004. And this was projected to last 10 years. It has lasted 4 to 7. The results were better, and they did last somewhat longer, which is attributed just to the larger quantity of alum being used. So in addition to the other solutions, Green Lake had an invasive carp population, much like Elk and Beaver Lake. So they attempted to address that by stocking some sterile tiger muskie, which were expected to eat the carp. However, 3 years later, the carp was still the dominant species, and it's still the dominant species. It's still a problem today. And one other factor is in 2011, the Washington state government passed a bylaw banning fertilizers containing phosphorus. So we'll see if that that has an effect. So the Friends of Green Lake is a group of concerned citizens who've studied the lake quite extensively. They've communicated with the public, and they lobby the government on issues relating to the lake. Despite all this effort, the lake experienced algal blooms, causing lake closures again in 2012. Excuse me. So the city of Seattle has committed $300,000 to study the lake, get the permits required for more alum treatments, and then a further $1.2 to $1.8 million to engage in another alum treatment, which they've committed to doing before next summer. They had to move it up. They were planning for summer 2017. They had to move it up just because of how bad the conditions were. And so here's an example. This is this past summer, a warning, and people not heeding the warning, I don't think. And this is a before and after, so you can see it was pretty bad. So this is right before that second large alum treatment, and then 10 months after. So just some closing remarks, which seem to align with what Dr. Nordin, his remarks were. First, fulsome study prior to implementing any techniques. We've seen when you don't figure out exactly what the problem is it external, is it internal, you can apply the technique that isn't effective. Second is having comprehensive long-term management and associated funding to avoid the sort of ad hoc reactive measures. Third is to continuously monitor to see how it's reacting to the treatment and be flexible as factors change, especially with climate change. And lastly, get as many stakeholders involved as possible, including the public and First Nations, and to get buy-in for the ultimate management plan. Thank you very much.
My name is Michelle Hawryluk. I am with the Ministry of Environment. I'm an environmental impact assessment biologist for them out of their Nanaimo office. I've been involved with this project since I arrived there a whopping 2 years ago. I'm here today to talk to you guys about the evaluation of remediation options at Elk Lake. This is a report that's currently in draft form. We actually, as a steering committee, had a chance to look at it first on October the 19th, So we're October 29th now. This is pretty fresh for us. I'm excited to be here and get to share some of this stuff with you guys. This report is being produced by Dr. Gertrude Nurnberg and Dr. Bruce Lizert. Both Dr. Nurnberg and Dr. Lizert, they work for a company called Freshwater Research, and that company is based in Ontario. That's a long way for them to come here tonight to present their analysis thus far, so I'll be presenting on their behalf. The report is being jointly funded by the BC Wildlife Federation, the Victoria Fish and Game Protective Association, the Victoria Golden Rods and Reels, and the Ministry of Environment. As Rick mentioned, this report is next on the list of studies that aims to help inform stakeholders and decision makers on what the next steps are to achieve improved water quality at Elk and Beaver Lakes. I apologize, like Rick, I tend to call it Elk Lake. So if I refer to that, I am meaning both basins. Before I do begin tonight, I would like to express my gratitude to see so many faces here tonight. I'm continually impressed by the consistency with which individuals and organizations continue to drive toward this goal of achieving better water quality there. I think that that old adage, it takes a village to raise a child, is pretty similar for environmental stuff as well. So Rick did a great job of providing the background in terms of studies and reports that have been conducted at the lakes over the years. I'm going to focus on just the last couple of years because they provide some context for the report. In 2013, there was a steering committee that was formed. The folks that sit on that committee are representatives from the Ministry of Environment, from Forest Lands and Natural Resource Operations, so those are our fisheries folks. Later on, we absorbed some regional hydrologists as well from that ministry. Also, the Capital Regional District, the District of Saanich, and Dr. Rick Nordin, as a representative from the BC Lake Stewardship Society. As you heard earlier, he has a long history at this lake, so he's a pretty invaluable resource. I remember in 2013 having Mick Collins from the Golden Rods and Reels come to a couple of those meetings, and that provided that connection that we needed with the stewardship group to keep the ball rolling, which is a lot of what they continue to do today. When we sat around that table in 2013, we essentially charted the course for the next couple of years. We worked together to develop a sampling program, and it was a pretty comprehensive sampling program, and we conducted that over 2014 to 2015. That program was big. Like I said, it was comprehensive. There was bi-weekly sampling that was being conducted both at the lake and in the streams around the lake, all in an effort to get a better understanding of the system. There's a lot of data from Elk and Beaver Lakes over the years, but we didn't have a lot that was current. And if we're going to go to the next step of spending some money to get some remediation options on the table, then we'd be doing ourselves a disservice if we didn't look at what the actual current state of the lake and the streams are. That work that was done in 2014, 2015, being such a large effort as it was, I have to say thanks to all the folks that made that happen. We had volunteers out from the Golden Rods and Reels every 2 weeks in a boat on the water. Rick was out there as well. We had our hydrologists from Forests and Lands. They were out there. Peninsula Stream Society not only funded but did some sampling for us as well. The districts of Saanich staff put together their people, and they were also out every 2 weeks doing sampling for an entire year. So it was no small feat. The Capital Regional District provided their lab efforts in kind, which was huge. And we also had a lot of support from the rowing club there that provided boats for a lot of the sampling. So the data that we collected in 2014, 2015 was all aimed towards getting us to this next stage. So here we are, it's 2015, and we've got a year of data, and we're using it to produce essentially three reports, one of which Rick basically addressed tonight. That's the overview of the status and the phosphorus budget as it currently stands at the lakes. We had a phosphorus budget done, as Rick mentioned, in I think it was 1988 by McKean, and so we were able to sort of update that. The next report is the evaluation of remediation options, which is currently in draft form, and that's what I'm going to speak to you guys about tonight. And the third report is an updated water quality objectives report. That's something that we're going to do internally. We do have water quality objectives for this lake, but again, as Rick mentioned, they're a bit out of date at this point, and we've got the data. So we expect for that report to be finished hopefully in December of this year. So before we roll too far into this, there are two things that are really important, two things that I want you guys to keep at the forefront of your minds because they sometimes get missed and we have to roll back to these. One is that there is no cheap, easy, one-size-fits-all solution in the world of water remediation. It just doesn't exist, and I think that that's been spoken to here tonight. What's more, the toolbox that we usually have becomes even smaller still when we examine lake-specific considerations. So things like the size of the lake, the bathymetry of the lake, the morphology, the actual water chemistry in that lake, the end users of the water in that lake, and obviously the cost that's associated with remediation options, those will get you whittled down to one, two, maybe three options. So Erin talked a lot about options that are used in different places. It's a very lake-specific situation, and I think Rick is right that in this situation there is nothing that fits perfectly. There rarely is. It's for that reason that some of the options or some of the case studies that you've heard about and you've read about and maybe you've Googled them yourself, they're not all addressed in the draft remediations report because we contracted somebody to look at what the viable options are at this lake, not the exhaustive list of the options that have been done the world over. The second thing that I want you guys to remember is that lake remediation has to be a two-pronged approach. There's two sides to this, and one of those is to deal with the issue that's at hand, so whatever that is. In this case, it's the lake, and we'll get into that. But the second is to look at the external inputs, and that means to develop a more comprehensive, further-reaching watershed management plan. If you deal with just the remediation that's going on in the lake or that's required at the lake, and you don't deal with that secondary part, then you're going to be back here however many years later in the same situation. So it needs to be a two-pronged approach and they need to happen simultaneously. Oftentimes we focus on just the immediate remediation effort. Okay, so let's talk about the report. It essentially is broken into three components. The first is a review and an update of what we call external phosphorus load versus internal phosphorus load. That's just science talk for where's the phosphorus coming from that's causing the algal blooms. So we needed to have a look at that again. The second part of the report deals with the potential remediation techniques that might be viable at these lakes. And the third part deals with the data gaps and the limitations that are associated with those potential techniques. So the first step in the report, again, was the review and the update of how much phosphorus comes from where and how this relates to the blooms that we're seeing. This is important because it tells us where to direct that first prong of the remediation effort. Where do we put our efforts to tackle the problem that's happening right now that we're seeing? Ignore the numbers for a second. We'll come back to that. They're less important. I want to make sure that you guys understand some of the terms that we often toss around and don't remember that not everybody has taken their limnology courses. So external refers to any phosphorus that is coming from outside of the lake. It's pretty intuitive. When we break that down, we're looking at phosphorus that is carried into the lake by way of tributaries. In the case of Elk and Beaver Lake, the largest tributary is O'Donnell on the northeast side there. One of the other avenues for external loading of phosphorus to get into the lake is ephemeral creeks. Ephemeral refers to creeks that run only during the rainy season. So these are the ones that dry up in the summer. Another source of phosphorus external loading comes from the atmosphere, so rain deposition. Septic systems, we've talked about those. There are 63 dwellings around this lake, and there are some septic systems. Bird excrement, sounds like it might not be a big deal. Turns out it can be. We do have a pretty healthy goose population around. And last but not least is agricultural. We know that the land use historically has been agricultural and to some extent still is today. A lot of that input ends up in the streams, through the soil, different mechanisms to get into the lake itself. So that's essentially what external phosphorus, external load is when we refer to it. Internal phosphorus loading is whatever's in the lake. So essentially, in the case of Elk Lake, what we're talking about is phosphorus that cycles between the water, the aquatic plants, and the sediment itself. So internal, it's all in the lake, it's going on right there, it doesn't really leave. The external are those inputs that are continually coming in. And this is a natural process. All lakes will build a phosphorus bank over time. I said that we don't need to really get into the numbers. What I want to mention here is that, like Rick mentioned, the largest contributing factor to these blooms is the internal load.
You can tell by these numbers. Rick said that 89 to 90%, somewhere in there, that's what we're looking at for the amount of phosphorus that's in the lake already versus the 224. So this is 6 to 8 times larger what's in the bank, in the lake, than what is actually still coming in. So that's important because it tells us where to focus that one prong of the remediation efforts. That smaller number is where we're going to look at the watershed management planning. The second part of the report looks at remediation options. Essentially, these can be divided into three categories. We've got physical treatment. There's some methods described there. I'll go into a little bit of detail. There's flow management, which in this case is referring to hypolimnetic withdrawal. And the third sort of category is phosphorus precipitation. So as Rick described, Elk and Beaver Lake thermally stratify in the summer, which means that that bottom layer of the water becomes void of oxygen. When there's no oxygen in the bottom layer, the phosphorus that normally lives in the sediment bound up is released back into the lake. What a method like destratification or artificial mixing would do is it would take those bottom waters and it would distribute them throughout the water column. Essentially, what you have then is that bank of nutrient-rich water that has no oxygen that is then being distributed throughout the lake. And what happens in that case is that if we do that in the summer period, which is when this is an issue, what you're doing is putting more groceries in the lake. So effectively, what you'd probably end up seeing is these cyanobacteria blooms occurring earlier than they do already. Similar situation with artificial mixing. There are applications where this works, but I'm just going to discuss for you guys what the issues are with respect to these lakes. Aeration and oxygenation is different than what I just described in that this is an application that is delivered directly into a discrete layer of the lake. So that bottom area of the lake that's void of oxygen and high in phosphorus, if we can get pure oxygen or air into that layer, then essentially what that does is it enables the conditions for that phosphorus to stay bound up in the sediment. Therefore, it's not available in the lake, and it can't be distributed throughout, and that those cyanobacteria don't have as much groceries to bloom. One thing that we do know about this lake is that it has an extremely high sediment oxygen demand at that sediment water interface. There's some question in the report about whether or not it's technically possible or feasible to get the amount of air or oxygen down there that would actually facilitate that binding of the phosphorus in the sediment. Something that all of the physical treatment options have in common is that they require continuous energy input. They require continuous management, continuous maintenance, continuous cost. Effectively, they're treating the symptoms versus the actual cause of the issue. So in the case of flow management, we're talking about hypolimnetic withdrawals. The picture in the middle that I've put up here was the best I could find. It shows water being siphoned out of that middle layer of the lake and out of the lake. At Elk Lake, picture that water being siphoned out of the bottom layer because, again, that is the layer of water that we're concerned with in the summer period because that is where that phosphorus is coming out of the sediment. So there's a couple of issues that have been identified with hypolimnetic withdrawal in Elk Lake. One of them is if you take water out of a lake and you want that lake level to stay the same, you need to put water back in the lake. We would be doing this at a time of year when there are no inputs coming in. Effectively, all the ephemeral creeks have dried up. The tributaries are very low, including O'Donnell Creek. The secondary issue with hypolimnetic withdrawal is that you're taking this volume of water that is in poor shape, let's say, and you would be effectively putting it potentially into Colquitt's Creek. So we're interested in solving the problem, not moving the problem. This would require treatment of that water, which again, there are associated costs with that. The last method that is discussed in the report is phosphorus precipitation. There are various ways to achieve this. In the report, it discusses a product called Phoslock. Phoslock is a bentonite clay. Essentially, it's something that is dispersed or applied, rather, at the top of the lake. Just like the diagram shows, it filters down through the lake. In the bentonite clay, there's a rare earth element that's called lanthanum, and what that does is it has a high affinity for bonding with biologically available phosphorus. So that phosphorus that's in situ in the lake essentially gets bound up by the lanthanum on its way down. It sits on the bottom of the lake. It's supposed to be a permanent method. It is supposed to be a one-stop shop if you get the dosage right. Phoslock is new to us. This wasn't something that we were expecting to see in this. We see a lot of aeration as the technique. You've seen it in the lakes around here, St. Mary, Glen Lake, Langford, lakes that we talked about tonight. Hypolimnetic aeration and also destratification. We've used those techniques before. We've not used Phoslock before. It's relatively young, I'll say. It's been used for just over 10 years the world over. It's proprietary. It's developed and sold exclusively from Australia, I believe. They've used it there for over 10 years. They've used it in Scotland, in Germany, in the Netherlands. The first North American application happened in 2010, and that was in California. So they've got 5 years under their belt. It was actually used in Canada in 2011 in Ontario. To my knowledge and the knowledge of my colleagues around the province, we've never used it here in this province. So this is uncharted territory for us and would require some further investigation. So this takes us to next steps. Like I said, we've just reviewed the draft report as a steering committee October the 19th. We have sent a laundry list of items that we would like to see further information on to the contractors. We're looking at a revised edition of that report, possibly a final report by the end of this calendar year. The steering committee at that point would be reviewing the recommended options. Next step would be a process of approval. In some cases, if we're going to go into uncharted territories, we might need to define what that process of approval looks like. There might be other bodies that need to come to the table, other organizations, jurisdictional stuff that we would need to sort through. There's stakeholder consultation. There are a lot of people that care about these lakes, and I think public forums and open houses are important. These are your lakes, these are our lakes. We're just helping to try and carry that mandate out. We're all working towards the same goal. So some public consultation for sure. And then there's fundraising and approvals. None of the things that I talked about tonight are cheap, none of them. They're all very expensive. So there's a process there. And then the actual, obviously, receiving the approvals themselves. And then there'd be implementation. So if you haven't got the picture yet, we're not quite there yet. You won't see something in the lake next summer, but I'm pretty confident, and I am the new kid on the block, but I'm pretty confident we're closer than we've been, I think, in a long time at getting somewhere on this lake. So that's the quick and dirty on what the draft is, where it's sitting at right now. And I hope you guys are excited, because we're excited. We want to get somewhere with this lake.
All right, so there you have it. We'll take questions now and open it up to you folks.
Yes. Yes, I've done a lot of work in the last few months with lakes around here, and what I have found is that you have to use oxygenation and a special technique to get the dissolved oxygen to about 9 or 10, because there's so much VOD happening in the lakes already. And then we were able to kill all the milfoil and algae blooms. Excuse me. And it works very effectively, like within 2 weeks, and it's very cheap. And what we found in all these lakes that we've done around here is, unless you use the injected oxygen, which is cheap to use because we generate it, you never catch up to the BOD, and you're always fighting it. All the nutrients are still going, excuse me, and it never gets anywhere. So we've been up against all the aerators and bubble diffusers, and they all failed compared to our technology. And City of Langford has bought one of our systems. They're very small, you can pick it up with one hand, and inexpensive, and it's new cutting edge technology, but it's really cheap. And you're basically putting the lake back to, you know, 1,000 years ago. It's like 10 parts per million, 11, 12 parts per million. And we're able to do up to 15 parts per million because the oxygen bubbles are so little that they stay in the lake for weeks. They don't rise up. And so it's able to get through all the deep areas. And I just want to make that point that there are some new processes coming out that are being proved locally that are pretty inexpensive.
So where is Langford using that?
Lake Ida Ann.
Any comments on that? Thanks for that information.
Oh, you're welcome.
Can I just, the options you outlined there, the options you outlined there with three remediation processes, were all the others thrown out as being either not appropriate or too expensive?
These were the only ones included in this first draft of the report, yes. So the experts have determined that these are the viable options, and there are several reasons why the other ones are not.
Yeah, define viable. Is viable cost, or is viable the lake, you can't do that at this lake?
It's not cost. Cost is not the factor. No, like I said, everything is expensive that we're looking at. It's more about whether or not that the lake-specific considerations match that technology.
Okay, because going right back to the doctor's talk there about the gigantic, and I have no idea the settlement was that deep, it's amazing. It seems to me that a combination makes far more sense than doing one thing in isolation. For example, the Foss log sounded like a great idea. If you dredge the lake first, then you're getting a whole bunch of it out, you're trapping what's left. Sounds like a great plan. I'm just curious why certain things were not considered viable. Why was dredging not considered viable? That to me sounded like the most viable option of all the Erin's thoughts they should talk about. Dredging seems to be fairly effective. At least if you deepen the lake and no other reason, which actually actually allow you to do something else. It'll actually let a little bit of water up, bring the edge back, put the edge of the lake back, because you're still at the same volume of the lake with the dirt moving as much of the sediment. You keep the volume, you lower the lake a little, bring the plants back to the edge of the lake all around the lake. That helps a whole bunch of reasons. So I'm curious why certain things were decided.
I'm not sure why it wasn't included. Can you hear me? I mean, I'm not sure why dredging wasn't included. It is done quite a lot in other areas. The problems with dredging is, number one, it's expensive. It's really expensive. You have to bring it out big barge. The biggest other problem with dredging. Is that actually doing it?
Yes.
The other big problem with dredging is, what do you do with the dredging, the material that you take out of the lake? It's mostly water. It's 90% water. And you have to put it somewhere.
You just have to put it somewhere until it dries, in which case it's now fertilized.
Yeah, but if you're going to take a significant amount out, it's usually several million cubic meters and when you do it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's the problem with the solution, believe me.
Yeah. I agree. Yes, a lot of people would like to have it as soil augmentation or something, because it's quite rich.
Okay.
Erin, you talked about, I think it was Delavan Lake, where they were looking at the value of the lake in terms of economic terms. I'm wondering what the parameters were that they used to do that valuation. The fact that there are so many people in this room tonight obviously shows that we all value the lake, and so it's trying to get that message out to a broader community.
Yeah, I don't have sort of the study specific. I'm happy to send it if you want to talk to me after. I can send you the source and you can have a look. So I don't know, because it's been valuing anything in the environment is problematic, and it's not a perfect science at all. So, I could send you that study, though, and you can have a look, and I don't know if that's something they would consider doing for this lake or not, or if that's necessary.
But it was over $70 million in that bit.
Yeah, that was the spend, the business spending, and the job. There was jobs involved too. And
you can imagine the value of Elk and Beaver Lake to this region.
Yeah,
like if you had to create that from nothing, how much would it cost you? And what would it cost us if that lake is no longer usable?
Now, I was just wondering if you had any idea how much you have to reduce the phosphorus loads by in order to control the weed and algae blooms to the level we want. Like, I understand that Most of it is from internal loading, but if we only have to reduce it by 15% in order to control the weed growth to the level we want, you know, should we be looking at controlling some of the external loading, which may be easier to control? I'm just curious.
Just to give you an idea, the phosphorus levels in Elk Lake now are around 40. And the usual rule of thumb is if you can get the concentration below 2, you won't have any alkyl blooms. So we have to get rid of 3/4 of the phosphorus.
What about the weeds?
The weeds are another question because they're generating nutrients and they're also using up oxygen. So they have to be dealt with as well.
This is not a question as such, but we, BC Wildlife Federation, would like to take credit for funding this, but in actual fact, it's a new president of the Canadian Wildlife Federation sitting right over there, and his partner from Ontario, who provided the funds which we husbanded until such time as they were needed, and the Habitat Conservation Trust Fund. But a comment is, here we've got Canadian Wildlife Federation here, BC Wildlife Federation here, and all you folks here, and it started with a phone call from Mick.
So we haven't talked about the carp issue yet, but it's not well known, but in England and Wales, people pay a lot of money to fish for big carp. And then when they catch them, they're forced to throw them back in again. So I've got an innovative solution to the carp problem. Put a $5 bounty on every carp removed from the lake. All our members would clean up in them.
At Lake George in Florida, where they harvested the gizzard, I think they charged the company that was fishing them like cents per fish. And I don't think they eat them, but they're used for other purposes. So it was a deal for them, and it was great for the lake. So it was it's an innovative solution.
They're really good for rose bushes.
Get the phosphorus out of the lake and into the rose bushes of Victoria. Ian, the Peninsula streams.
Yeah, I was just wondering, the export of phosphorus through the harvesting of the weeds, the milfoil, and then also is there opportunities to harvest and export phosphorus from the algae blooms themselves? So comment on that.
Getting rid of phosphorus through the weeds is really hard. The weeds are mostly...
Rick, use the main mic. Just walk out.
The studies that have been done trying to export phosphorus by getting rid of the weeds don't work very well. Aquatic plants are mostly water and really don't have very much phosphorus content to them. What they do have is a lot of carbon, which uses up the oxygen in the lake. So it is good to get rid of them, but using them to get rid of phosphorus doesn't work very well. A shovel full of lake sediment has a lot more than a ton of weeds.
So when the cyanobacteria bloom, how much phosphate are they taking up in that bloom process? If you're at 40 parts, would they take it down to 35 parts?
they're not actually taking it out, they're just recycling it, basically. I mean, it's the 40 is measuring all the phosphorus that's in the water. So some of it's in the water, some of it's in the algae, and it just gets cycled around.
Thank you.
It seems to me that there's, just listening to that gentleman over there, there's a lot of us in here that have solutions to this problem that nobody seems to know about. And part of the reason is because there's always a study being done, and the study always excludes people like us that have innovative technologies. My suggestion would be, listening to Erin, I mean, the numbers out there when you're talking about the overall solution are huge, and I totally agree with it. It's millions of dollars. But to do small tests in a lake like Elk Lake, to me, sounds like a really worthwhile solution. And that is to take entrepreneurs like us and say, okay, well, let's cordon off a small section of the lake, and let's put something in there and see if it works. And it might cost $50,000 to $100,000 to do it. But I think with the amount of interest that I'm seeing here, raising $50,000 to $100,000 to try something completely new doesn't seem a crazy idea to me. I think collectively people could raise that kind of money. You could cordon it off. I mean, the technology we've been doing is exactly that. Cordon off a certain area, and we do all these tests for BRV and, you know, chemical oxygen demand, dissolved oxygen measurements, aeration, all of the different things. And we've done this before with algae blooms and completely got rid of them altogether. But again, it always comes back to, well, what commercial venture have you done? And then people start listening. So I think, you know, I'd like us in Victoria to get together with all the entrepreneurs and say, A, we can raise the money, and B, let's try something that you've never tried before.
What do you say, provincial government?
I'll leave you my card.
Okay. Thank you. I'd like to make an observation, perhaps offer a question to you before. One, about the FOSS lock and pouring the chemical into the lake to cover it up. Covering things up in the past hasn't historically worked very well for us. We've only looked at nuclear waste and other solutions. Covering it up isn't always the greatest thing. It can come back and haunt us. So I would urge the panel to look for another solution in covering this one up. My second observation, perhaps a question, is there not the chemical, is there not a chemical solution, a biomolecular solution to render the phosphorus inert? And thirdly, you talk about the cost of dredging. Why can't we take what you pull out and sell it to Alberta? They've been selling us a lot for enough time. Sell something they need back in their cultural.
So we'll have a pipeline of blue green algae going to Alberta.
Phosphorus binding is what phosphoc does. That's its claim to fame, is that it does bind the phosphorus.
For a time.
It's pretty permanent. Lanthanum is a very permanent one.
Barring disturbance.
Not sure, anyway.
I can't speak to that either yet.
And phosphoc is a clay? Is it a natural occurring clay?
Natural occurring clay that they've augmented with this lanthanum, which is a metal.
Which is a naturally occurring metal, but have manipulated the compound.
Sorry, I want to make sure I understand that. Clay is not simply covering it up. It's actually this ingredient within it that they add to it, chemically binds the phosphorus.
Yes.
So, okay, so it's fun to talk about the technical side and the solutions and stuff. But my question is, so who are the deciders? So several people have suggested there may be some innovative techniques that they want to talk to folks who might be willing to look at that. You mentioned that there was a steering committee. Is that a complete committee now? Is that steering committee going to take the reins of this and make some decisions about what's going to happen in the lake? What happens from this point forward in terms of who decides and who's going to be responsible for this?
The steering committee that exists now that has everybody from the jurisdictions as we know it, Rick has pointed out that we might not have jurisdictional clarity. There might be organizations like BEHA and other health authorities that might need to be at this table. But effectively, that steering committee are the decision makers. As the resource managers with, again, information from the public and feedback. So I was serious when I said I'll leave you my card.
I would have said that it is so refreshing to hear, because all of us have been sitting listening to our new sewage treatment plant for I don't know how many years now, and all we hear is, oh, we have to do another study, oh, we have to do another study, until you just have to run out of steam. I mean, there's just only so many studies you can do, and somebody's going to stand up and say, we have a solution, let's at least try something. Let's just do something instead of staring at studies over and over. So it's so refreshing.
So we have another question from back here.
Well, I'd just like to follow up on what the previous gentleman said about who are the decision makers. In my experience, the decision makers are people with multiple purse strings, because the ultimate decision will be whose money is going to be spent, how much money is there. And secondly, the decision makers are the regulators and the permitters, not the science. I don't think we've ever had a problem with the science, and clearly your steering committee has got the science behind it and you can come up with a solution. It seems to me the real key is you've got to get the permitting people, many of whom are in the provincial network and different parts of the ministry. We know that the bottom of the lake is owned by the forests, lands, natural resources, people, they will decide what happens in that regard. We know that the Ministry of Environment is going to be involved if you're going to start depositing or extracting anything from the lake, moving dredging around, that kind of thing. We know you can't put any works into the lake unless you get Transport Canada approval because it's navigable water. We know that the CRD controls the land around the edge of the lake, and on it goes. We've talked about the Vancouver Health Authority having jurisdiction. Unless we can get the regulators all linked and working with the scientists, and then get those linked with the people who hold the purse strings, it gives every one of those groups the opportunity to say, someone else is working on the problem, and so I don't have to actually make the final decision. Study, 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 but I don't have to make the decision. So it seems to me that one of the initiatives that we've heard about in the last week or so coming from the CRD, was an initiative to hire a person who could try to pull together, not just the scientists, you guys have done a good job of that, but all these other people that I just mentioned. There are just so many jurisdictions involved, and you need to come up with a way to link the management, and it raises some very significant legal issues as to who's going to delegate their authority and their decision-making to who, who's going to take the lead, who's allowed to do that, what kind of challenges are you going to get from the small tyranny of the public interest groups? There'll always be someone who objects to whatever you decide to do. How are you going to fight that off? So my suggestion to the group, if we want to move forward, is not only to support what you're doing with the science, but I think we need to tell our local government politicians, the municipal councillors and the CRD directors, that we want someone to take on the coordination and pull all of these groups together. I think it's a great initiative that they have there. They have to make a decision in the next 2 weeks to spend that money. They're talking about hiring somebody. And that person's going to have to understand all of those intricate regulatory, legal, and connection with science issues. Otherwise, we get nowhere. Mm-hmm. We've seen it in so many different places. It's not, we don't need to reinvent the wheel. 30 years ago, the Fraser River Estuary managed to pull together 27 different agencies, and they have a single window where these kinds of decisions, applications go in, decisions come out. They have a lot more development to deal with. But we still have some science-based decisions to make, and particularly spending money. unless we can coordinate it all and nail it down, it's just going to get passed around and around and around.
But you know, I think this meeting is the beginning of the solution, because we have had a situation where agencies are pointing to each other and saying it's not our responsibility, it's somebody else's responsibility. And the missing thing is the public will, because bringing out this many people on this issue is a good indication that the public is really concerned about Elk and Beaver Lake. And if we can keep that public awareness and public pressure on, all that bureaucratic quagmire and the bureaucratic status quo will break, because there will be a political will. The politicians will say, get it done. The public wants Elk and Beaver Lake cleaned up.
My question is, I did a lot of the water quality testing on St. Mary, and also on Hawryluk Creek. And I've been, just through my own interest, I've been looking at a lot of this, the technology and solutions and things like that for controlling phosphorus. And I'm very, very curious to know, not in a sort of, tell me why you've eliminated a bunch of the different types of solutions, but very curious as to is there any documentation of how some of these solutions were decided upon that wouldn't be appropriate for Elk and Beaver Lake, and what were those parameters that made them not viable solutions? I'm just very curious to know more about how they were eliminated. And wondering if one of them was, because I haven't heard anybody talk about it, is the sort of floating vegetative islands, the artificial islands, but you know, where you're planting up a floating island with vegetation that the roots are submerged in the lake and they're taking up phosphorus. And these can be very small, and they can be very, very large. I mean, even with small trees and stuff on them. And maybe that's not suitable for Elk Lake because you know, it takes up a lot of space and there's you know, it's an active water body. But just wondering, some of those sorts of technologies, if there's any sort of documentation of why they don't work for this particular thing.
The rationale for the remediation options that are being looked at by the experts who are writing this report will be in the report. So once that is released to the public, that you'll be able to see those in there. I didn't go into too much depth because in some cases we are now pushing for more information on that to flesh it out. We want for the decision makers, the public, for everybody that has a vested interest in this lake to understand the reasons why certain things were more viable than others. There won't be a laundry list of every option, like I said, that's out there in here, because we've got limited resources to do a report to get us moving forward. So there will be rationale for the options that are in there. There won't be an exhaustive list of everything. And with respect to the biomass that you're referring to, I think they're a great small-scale option that can be used, but I think you've hit it on the head. In Elk Lake, we're looking at, one, a much larger scale of an issue, and two, you're looking at navigable waters and other issues on high-use water bodies. So that's the reason why they weren't mentioned here. I hope that helps.
Yeah. We have another question in the back.
Has the interplay between the bullfrogs and the pumpkin seed fish and the vegetation and the algal blooms, has that also been considered, and might there be any multi-pronged solutions that involve looking at some of those invasive species that are actually in the water?
They're not incorporated in the report that I discussed tonight, because that's focusing strictly on remediation options to do with the phosphorus, which is what the issue is at hand here in the lake. I'm not sure if there is an interaction between bullfrogs and phosphorus. Do you know, Rick? Yeah, I don't think we're quite out in that level yet. That, you know what I mean? Like, that's a bit, it's a level. level back from what we're talking about so far in the conference.
We have somebody to make an answer.
In experimental studies, ballpark tadpoles are really good focus leaders, and they reduce alpha biomass, but it's only in experiments, small pieces of focus studies that they've done it, they haven't shown it in a
Maybe one more question, and then we're going to talk about where we go from here.
Any plans to repair or replace the milfoil harvester, which could take care of the lake superficially very quickly, making it easier for boaters and swimmers?
I can speak to that, because I was at the CRD Parks meeting last week. The CRD Parks Committee has passed a recommendation to purchase a new big harvester equivalent to the one they had that broke down several years ago. The one they had on contract the last couple of years didn't work, it's been rejected. It's on the agenda for the CRD meeting November 18th, I think it is. And anybody and everybody who thinks we should have a weed harvester needs to phone up a counselor or a director that you know and tell them, please vote to spend the money to buy a weed harvester. Otherwise, we're not going to have it.
What's the telephone number?
I can tell you, if you go to the CRD website, every one of those directors has their home phone number on there. I was amazed to see these guys still put out their home phone number to people like me who love the fact.
So, okay, just one more here.
Yeah, hi, I'm one of those directors.
Oh, great.
And actually, my motion was to hire a consultant. View that positively.
Louder.
I was saying, hello, can you hear me now?
Yes.
So I was the director who put forward a motion to hire the consultant. I sit on the Parks Committee. The health of Elk and Beaver Lake is so important, and if we can get as much public support as we can, we get this problem solved.
Yeah. We need more politicians like you. And so, where do we go from here? First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Nordin and Michelle and Erin. I just feel privileged to work at the Environmental Law Center and work with the next generation of public interest lawyers like Erin, who was able to bring her expertise. And also, one of the great things about working at the Environmental Law Center is to have community groups come to us and ask for help in facilitating change. And I think this is a really great example of how change can happen. The solution to this problem is not just the aerators, it's not just the alum or the phlox or whatever those technical solutions are. The solution is you. And if you people come together, it was inspiring to me to be in that other room and see fishermen talking to rowers, talking to conservationists, talking to biologists and to people with innovative technologies and about the ways that we can solve this problem. So let's not just let this meeting be a one-shot affair. Let's connect with each other. Let's connect with the Rod and Reel Society, with the BC Wildlife Federation, with the Canadian Wildlife Federation, the Peninsula Streams, all the different groups. The capacity that's in this room to make change is incredible. Like, we can see the restoration of these lakes. It'll just take a bit of sweat. It'll take some perseverance. It'll take your intelligence and your commitment to this. But the Environmental Law Center is pleased to work with you. And hopefully we'll come together in a meeting in the near future where we talk about a tangible plan from the provincial government, from the Capital Regional District, from the Vancouver Island Health Authority, from the federal government, on how we're going to clean up those waters so that your grandkids can swim in that lake and not worry about blue-green algae, and your kids can go out and row in that lake and not worry about tipping over because of the weeds. We can do it, but we have to work together. Thank you very much for coming.
I just want to do some acknowledgements, if you'll bear with us.
In terms of the practicalities of how you get involved, Peninsula Streams booth is right outside the door there. Become a member, $5. Think about donating to them. It cost us out of pocket about $1,500, and that was with this, all this free research and this fine facility. And it is important to recognize all the sponsorship we've had. I'm with, as you know, many of you, Victoria Golden Rods and Reels. We generated $26,500 from different sources. We garnered all kinds of volunteer time. The market value I put on that time was $125,000 a year in cash, in kind, in volunteer labor. The groups that contributed to that, Canadian Wildlife Federation, BC Wildlife Federation, BC Lake Stewardship Society, Habitat Conservation Trust Foundation, Freshwater Fisheries Society of BC, Peninsula Streams and the Colquitts Coalition, Victoria Fish and Game Protective Association, Victoria Rowing Society, Rowing Canada, and Victoria City Rowing Club. Our group, Lisa Rogers, has done work for us as well. She was involved in St. Mary's Lake. So I don't want to hold you up any longer tonight. We called it, I coined a Tale of Two Lakes. We have to work together. We started with water sampling, but we had to get political. We had to do a lot of lobbying, take politicians out on the lake, write position papers, go in front of committees. So sign up, you can get involved in water quality monitoring, stewardship groups, politics, whatever turns your crank. And I'm going to just finish with a few lines of Dickens from A Tale of Two Cities. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom. It was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of glee. It was the epoch of incredulity. It was the season of light. It was the season of darkness. We had everything before us. We had nothing before us. We were all going direct to heaven. We were all going direct the other way. Let's work on getting to heaven together. Thank you.